Okay, so we will now have the final lecture of the school before we go to Durham. And Blaise will finish telling us about non-possible approaches to transport.
Hi again. Okay, so yesterday we talked about hydrodynamics. And we started in Lorentzian variant hydrodynamics. Then we went a little bit beyond that by introducing small momentum relaxation rate. What we saw is that introducing momentum relaxation allowed us to get finite DC conductivities. And then I ended up by telling you about this experiment that uses these formulae to show that you expect some relation of this voltage amount of Hobbs' law, which is this ratio between the heat and charge conductivities. And in a weakly coupled metal, this would be some universal number, and in a strongly coupled material, in the hydrodynamic regime, the heat and charge are not transported by the same processes, so that you have a violation of this Lorentz ratio. Now, the outlook of the first lecture was that, all right, hydrodynamics tells us how to write down constitutive relations in terms of a certain number of transport coefficients and thermodynamic quantities, but it does not compute these things for us. It just tells us how they appear in various conductivities, or more generally, in the Ricardi Green's functions. So, ideally, what we want to do now is to find a way of computing these things. Also, another thing that we would like to do is go to the regime where momentum relaxes quickly. And this is outside of the regime of validity of these hydrodynamic equations. So let me tell you a little bit first before we move on. We'll move on to ADS 15 in a couple slides. But before we do that, I wanted to stress again that so one way you can compute this momentum relaxation rate is by perturbing around some inhomogeneous background, considered a spatially varying background. So now this T bar, which was the equilibrium value, I was considering that to be homogeneous in the last lecture. Now you can imagine that this is slowly varying and then you're perturbing around that. And now you can just use the usual conservation equations for the stress sensor and current. You don't need to modify them to add by hand. This, if you remember what I had done, is I added by hand this momentum relaxation rate. But if you perturb around an inhomogeneous background, then you don't need to do that. And you would get the same functional form for the conductivities, and you would get some expression for the momentum relaxation rate. I'm not showing the details here because it's a bit long and technical. But what I did want to explain to you a little bit about it is that you can get the same results by using this local memory matrix approach. I will be very brief about it. I will just give you the general idea because this will need a whole other lecture to explain to you basically how I get to this format. But let me try to justify it. So the idea of the memory matrix formalism is that you're just thinking about your space of operator in your input space, and you're thinking of dividing them out between two sets, a set of slow operators and a set of fast operators. Fast operators are those that decay very quickly. And so typically these you don't keep track of. And slow operators are those that are almost conserved. So say like momentum, if I'm in a very clean material, so momentum will be long-lived. And operators that overlap with momentum. So in the simplest case, I can just think of the electrical current and momentum current. These are just the two operators that I want to think of. Yes.
So this, I don't know anything about this. My questions are really naive or nonsensical, but anyway. So this separation between these observables, of course, I guess depends on the state you're looking at.
So yeah, in principle, this separation is completely arbitrary, at least when you start the calculation. It just so happens that at the end of the calculation, you get some complicated formula for. Let me go through this. I'll come back to your question. It might be clear what happens. So you have your Hilbert space, and now you have these almost conserved operators. If they're almost conserved, it means that they have a time derivative which is non-zero. So if I just write out so p dot, okay, let me focus on momentum. What it means if it's non-zero is that the Hamiltonian contains a piece that does not commute with p. that's the content of that equation. And I can imagine writing this delta H as some operator imagine that delta H in general is some operator that has some coupling that depends on space and some expectation value. It can be more complicated, you can add ABC if you like, etc. But at the heart of it, this is what's going on. So then I just plug this in there and I act with momentum on the operator. And so I just get the derivative of that.
I
find
that this is small number in front of it.
I'm sorry.
The fact that this momentum is small, this P dot is small.
Yes.
So there's a small coupling.
Yes, yes. Here we're imagining there's some epsilon sitting in front.
And what do you mean by the overlap of the operator that something overlaps with some of the operator?
So this is, for instance, one example that I was mentioning in the last lecture, is that if you calculate the static susceptibility of the current with momentum, so this by definition delta J, say around x, divided by the source of momentum going on the x direction, so that's just the velocity. And you can see from the hydrodynamic formula, for instance, there are other ways to see it, but this is a quick way of seeing it, that since Jx is rho Vx plus sub-degree terms, then this is the density. So at non-zero density, we know that the electrical current overlaps with momentum. What it means is that if momentum flows, then the current also flows.
So in the quantum mechanics, you would be saying that there is some operator relation between these different operators, you are saying that they are overlapping?
No. I guess what I want to say is that if I have some set of operator, this is the statement, that JA, the set of operator JA is related by this matrix of static susceptibilities to the set of sources sigma B. And yes, you can think of that as an operator relation.
This is not the algebra, right?
Yes, precisely.
The star is not the algebra.
So now what you can do is you can define some inner product in the space of operators. And if you choose your inner, you can define your inner product in such a way that it has all the nice properties of an actual product in a Hilbert space. And if you choose it carefully, then you will realize that this inner product, there are many possible choices, but there's one choice that's nice in particular. It's a choice where essentially the product between two operators A and B is directly giving you the conductivity between A and B. So I over omega, the retarding function of J, essentially. So there's a way of computing these Green's functions, just thinking in terms of operators and their overlap. So now that you will do it, so if you use this kind of reasoning, these kind of calculations, at the end of the day, what we want to do is calculate sigma JJ. So here we're imagining that A and B are both J, because we want to calculate the electrical conductivity. And now what you find is that you can express it in a very simple form. So you see that the structure of this equation is that, maybe I should have written it slightly differently, this is essentially chi jp, some pp matrix element, chi jp. So this is telling you that sigma jj is given by the overlap between j and p. So maybe you can write this like that. That the overlap between j and p, where in principle this sum should run over all the long-lived operators. But here I've made the assumption that I only have one, so the sum only runs over one index. But if I had several, then I would have to run over all of these concept operators. And then in here in this parenthesis I have some other matrix elements, which is this guy. And importantly what appears there, it's parameterized and so there's some pole, and the width of that pole is parameterized by this matrix element. This is where the memory matrix and this MPP, it just ends up being proportional to the imaginary part, the retarding function of P dot, so the time derivative of P. And now to compute that, I just need to plug in the fact that P dot is this thing, do the intervals, and then have so what I call G here, or H here. So I just plug P dots in this formula, and then this is why, so since I have P dot, this is why I get an H squared, etc., etc. So what this allows me to get is some is an alternative formula for the momentum relaxation rate in terms of the spectral weight of the operator cone that breaks translations in my theory. So if I know the operator cone, and if I know how to compute its metabolic Green's function in spectral weight, then I can compute the momentum relaxation rate per the battery kit when it's small. And what I also find is the is how the momentum relaxation rate appears in the expression for the conductivity. Now if you remember the kind of expressions we saw yesterday, this is precisely what we got from a version of hydrodynamics with momentum relaxation. Except that here, the nice thing about the memory matrix is that I've never assumed anywhere that I was in the hydrodynamic regime. So in particular, this would still work at very low temperatures. You don't need omega much less than T for this to work.
Just to understand what you're doing, like you're computing sigma z is some 2.4 regression function.
Yes.
Of two operator.
Yes.
You're putting an identity thing, and then expanding it and set up operators, all the operators with theory. And then there are some operators which are like more significantly to
this. That's exactly right. So those that don't contribute are thrown away. And I truncate that sum to the operator that contributes the most, which in this case is just momentum.
And just to understand, I think, how did you decide which operators were the ones which were contributing more?
So this is an assumption. Like I said, the sum runs in principle over all operators in the Hilbert space that overlap with momentum. So this is an infinite set, but most of these operators are short-lived. They're not protected by a symmetry. So they don't have any reason to be conserved, and they will in fact decay quickly. The only operators that will survive are those that are protected by a symmetry. And in my case, I'm imagining that I'm weakly breaking translations. So P is no longer protected, but it's still very long-lived. But you can imagine doing this kind of procedure to many different systems. For instance, you can do that in a superfluid where you have vortices moving around that are relaxing the supercurrent. And you could also get similar formula and it would also work out. So there are many different systems where this could be applicable.
This is that there is some physical input that you put in by hand. There is not some intuition about what are the operators that you continue to move.
Yes.
The
formula that you get is so not this formula, general formula that you get with the sum running over all indices would be completely exact, but in practice completely useless because you don't know how to compute all of these things. So then you make an assumption that certain operators are long lived and these are the operators that would dominate. Well, said otherwise, you have some general matrix M that appears here. And essentially, what I'm asking is whether there's an eigenvalue that dominates or not. That's the assumption that I'm making. Okay, so what I want you to keep in mind is that we can get some prediction for the momentum relaxation rate in terms of the spectral weight of the operator that breaks translations, because that will come back later. If your operator is say the stress energy tensor or the parabola or the density, so if you imagine that you have disorder that contributes to some energy or some charge, and you plug this in there, and you use hydrodynamics to compute these retarding Green's functions, then what you will find is that this momentum relaxation rate is basically controlled by these first order coefficients that we saw in the last lecture. So the shear viscosity and this kind of realistic amount. And using this procedure, the further memory matrix, you recover the exact same formula from this version of hydrodynamics. So essentially, this is just to say that these two methods are very different, but mutually consistent. So that's all I want to say about the memory matrix for now. What I want to do after this. So just to make clear, so this memory matrix computation, this is still valid when this momentum relaxation rate is very small. So we're still in this case, where there's this single pole that's purely imaginary, which is parametrically separated from all these microscopic new poles. So because it's parametrically separated, this is why I can truncate the dynamics to just knowledge in this book. But as soon as I increase the amount of disorder, as soon as I increase my generalization, what happens is that this pole, it comes down the imaginary axis, and then it's getting closer to all these people. And once it's on the same order as all of these poles, then essentially I need to know all of them in order to make any kind of prediction about how, say, connectivity will come. I'm not allowed to just look at this book, I need to look at everything. And then this kind of conservative approach that I was mentioning can break down. So one of the nice things about ADS-CFT is that, sure, one thing that we'll be able to do is, in the regime where the transition is slow, we'll be able to check this kind of formulae. And that's the formula we get here agrees with that. But we will also be able to see what happens during this crossover between these slow and fast momentum transmission machines. And there are actually very few tools that allow you to do this. This is one of the only ones where you can do this kind of calculations. Okay. So what we need to do is come up with some model, ADS-CFT model. Here I will not, so sorry for the top-down people. Here I'm not going to care about whether this can be embedded in string theory or anything like that. The only thing I would care about is that this has the right symmetries. And as I will show you, this reduces the correct physical features of transport. All of these characteristics that I've been telling you about, we'll see that they come out from this particular terminal. So we want a terminal in ADS-CFT that breaks translation symmetry. Of course, the most general thing that we should be doing is, you know, think about some ADS paste and turn on some relevant deformation in the UV that has some general space dependence, and see how this back reacts on the metric, and then compute. You can do that. It's very complicated. It's a lot of work. There are some analytical results that you can get, but most of it is numerical. You have to solve PDEs, so then you run into a lot of problems about the accuracy of your numerics. And even once you have your numerical solution, then it's kind of hard to vary stuff because you have to compute again. So you can do all of these things if you're powerful enough, but essentially you can get the same intuition from everything that I will tell you in a much simpler set of models. So in these models, what we do is we turn on a set of massless scalars along each of the spatial directions, and we make the ansatz that these scalars are just some integration constant m times one of the spatial coordinates. Now, when you plug these in Einstein's equations, since these are massless, these scalars, they always appear with a derivative in Einstein's equations. So all the spatial dependence always drops out. And all you're left with are terms that are radially dependent and proportional to m squared, essentially. So somehow you've made an ansatz that allows you to keep ordinary differential equations instead of having to solve PDEs. So of course there's an assumption, etc., behind it, but as we will see, this is enough to understand something about transport. So because of this feature, I can just take an ansatz that's radially dependent. And actually, the set of equations are sufficiently simple that I can find an analytical solution that is just some small modification of the Schwarzschild solution. If you set m to 0 there, you would just get Schwarzschild ADS back. So here you see that there's a couple of extra terms due to the fact that I have this new integration constant.
And that p of psi is n.
Yes, exactly.
So it's n squared.
Yes. And Einstein
just changing the topological constant, no?
So what happens is that in Einstein's equations you'll have terms like d psi x squared, and that's g x x dx psi x dx psi x. So this contributes n squared. But this will contribute in my gauge part of the minus 2, so this will not be just a constant term. And actually, you can see that when you solve the equations, this term right here, it comes with one over r squared theta. So the cosmological constant is there. I've set the ADS to units. So you can see that this is not trivial. It's not just an effective cosmological constant. Now you can use standard holographic normalization. So you know that in the presence of a scalar deformation, the conservation equation for the stress tensor gets a right-hand side. And the right-hand side looks like this. So there's the bag of the operator times the derivative of the source. Now, here the source is just n times x, n times y, so you see that this is going to be non-zero. The wave is zero for the background, but it will turn on for once you look at fluctuations. The important point is that because of these ansatz, we get, I'm missing some instances here, we'll fix that. But project this along time, the mu equals t, this will tell you about energy conservation. Now this right-hand side drops out, because the sources don't depend on time. So energy is still conserved. However, if you look at the spatial component, so mu equals x, for instance, this is the momentum conservation equation. And now you see that this right-hand side is non-trivial because this should be a mu. So this derivative, when it's a spatial derivative, gives a non-zero source. So effectively, we're doing something that looks a lot like momentum. So now what we'll do is we'll compute the conductivities in this model and see that essentially we get the same kind of results as what we saw in this using these other approaches. So we want to compute the heat conductivity. Here I said that I'm working at zero density, so I will only be computing the thermal conductivity. I won't talk anymore about the electrical conductivity. That's just for simplicity. Because I want to show you guys how these computations work out, and it's just simpler to do it at zero density. Less equations, less fields, but the logic would be the same if you were to turn on the density. So I want to compute the heat conductivity. This is the derivative of the heat current with respect to the temperature gradient, and the set of metric fluctuations that we need to turn on is essentially the GTX, metric perturbation, the GRX, and then the perturbation of the scalar field, psi x. The reason why you can only turn on these is basically due to symmetry. So these are the ones that transform in the same way under parity x goes to minus x. And now we'll make an ansatz for the metric perturbation. And this ansatz is the following. Imagine that there's a piece that's linear in time and another piece that's purely radially dependent. So now what we do is we work out what are the linear equations, and we plug in that ansatz. And so for these guys, these are just radial functions. Now when you do that, because I've chosen the prefactor here to be r squared f, so I'm going to remind you that essentially r squared f is just the GTT metric element. So when I make this ansatz, I see from just looking, plugging it in the fluctuation equations, that all the time dependence drops out. So this linear in time source does not introduce extra time dependence in the fluctuation equations. And I can just solve these fluctuation equations. But at this point, what you're probably asking yourself is, why did I turn on this particular source? And why is this doing what I want? What I want is to turn on the temperature gradient. So you might be asking, why is this turning the temperature gradient? In order to see why this is doing exactly that, you just need to do a change of coordinates at the boundary. So you redefine your time coordinate to go from the time coordinate t to t bar, and then you transform it with this term, zeta. So zeta is just some constant. T bar times x. So you plug this in, and what you find out is that this term will cancel that one. So now at the boundary, I will no longer have the dx dt bar metric element. And we will modify the dt bar squared, I don't think this way. So it introduces some spatial dependence here. And now if you were to compute the temperature of the perturbed metric, you would find that there's a temperature gradient that's proportional to zeta. So this is actually doing what I wanted to do. It's turning on the temperature gradient. I should say that. So I would sketch the computation. I might not go to enough details for your taste, but if you really want to know everything, you should look at this paper by Lawrence.
And then if you want to know the technical potential, you have to know this A0.
Yes, that's right. Now the next thing we do is we start very hard at the perturbation equations, and then we realize that we can extract from them some radially conserved quantity. So I have some function Q of R that has zero radial derivative, and this can be expressed in terms of this delta GTX natural perturbation that I'm left with. The reason it's there for a very good reason, there's some symmetry, etc. I mean, I'll go into that, but if you're interested, I'm happy to answer a question at the end or whatever. Then what you do is you look at what this does asymptotically. You send R to infinity to the boundary, you use the usual holographic renormalization techniques and expansion around the ADS boundary, and then you prove that this radially conserved quantity, this Q of R, directly asymptotes to the momentum in your boundary flow theory. So this is actually the heat current. But the nice thing is that this is radially conserved. We've shown that at one end of spacetime, this is computing the momentum. But since it's radially conserved, we might as well evaluate it at the horizon. And when we do that, this will, at the end of the day, at the end of the slide, this will give us an expression for the heat conductivity that's very simple. Another important ingredient is the boundary conditions. So we're solving for this function GTX of R, essentially. And one standard thing that we always need to do when we compute transport coefficients in ADS CFT is that we need to compute ingoing boundary conditions that basically encode regularity in the horizon. The intuition behind that is that the horizon is a dissipative object. So you know, things fall in but don't come out. This is a classical calculation. These ingoing boundary conditions also translate in terms of regularity of the fields at the horizon. So we don't want things to diverge. But now there's a subtlety. So you know probably from your GR course that you cannot trust the Schwarzschild coordinate system at the horizon. This is not well defined. You need to go to a different coordinate system that actually allows you to cross the horizon radius. And to actually see that the horizon radius is just some coordinate similarity, it's not a true curvature similarity. So this coordinate system, one of them is the Eddington-Finkelstein coordinate. So what you do with the Eddington-Finkelstein coordinate is basically you redefine your time coordinate such that you can go through. So you have this Eddington-Finkelstein time now. Close to the horizon, there's also this log piece, log of R minus RH. And when you do this transformation, you find that your metric is completely regular at the horizon. But now, what we see is, remember that this is the ansatz that I made for the GTX metric element. This has an explicit factor of time. So now when I do the change to any configuration coordinates, you see that this linear in time piece, so it will give me a linear in V piece, that's fine, I'm happy with that. But it's also going to give me a log. So that if I don't do anything about this log, then that metric perturbation will blow up at the horizon, because the log blows up there. And what I actually need to do is impose a boundary condition on that part of the perturbation so that it compensates out the log. So what I need to do is, so here there shouldn't be, so this is actually delta G of R function. What I need to do is, I need to say that this is going to be something at the horizon, but there's also going to be a piece that will compensate out the log that comes from the change of coordinates. Now that this does, this is pretty good. Because as you can see, so here there's a radial derivative of this guy that I'm going to evaluate at the horizon. But this log will not disappear and will give me something that's zero. But it will also, more importantly, give me something that's proportional to the source. This zeta is my temperature gradient. So effectively, what imposing regularity in any Finkelstein coordinate does is that it relates the value of the heat current at the horizon to the UV source. And I can simply divide this by the source and find that the heat conductivity takes some very nice expression in terms of the entropy density, the Hawking temperature, and this parameter n. So this is a computation at zero density for the thermal conductivity, but it carries through for once you turn on non-zero density. It even carries through if you do the more general inhomogeneous boundary condition calculation. So forget about turning these massless scalars, just take ADS, perturb it by some spatially varying chemical potential. You can carry the exact same procedure. You'll get something more complicated for the heat conductivity, but the same logic applies. So it's a very powerful technique. And it really relies on the fact that you have these regionally conserved quantities that asymptote to the heat or to the electrical current. So we now have an expression for the thermal conductivity in this time of. So now let's see what happens. So we expect that when this parameter n is small, then translation should be quickly broken, right? Because distilled that is explicitly breaking translations in my system is going to be, it has a small source. So if n is small, then it's natural to expect that the results that we get should match the results from hydrodynamics or from the membrane matrix that we saw in the previous discussion. So that's exactly what you can do. First, this is the expression for the heat conductivity that we got either from hydrodynamics or from the membrane matrix. Now this type PP, that's just E plus P, and E plus P at zero density is just the entropy times the temperature. So actually this type PP, you can replace it by S times D, and you see that it simplifies out with the numerator, and all you're left with is S over gamma, the momentum relaxation rate. Now I can take this expression for the thermal conductivity that we just got from the previous slide, but in the previous slide I made no assumptions on the value of M. I didn't assume that it was small, large, anything. M is whatever it is. So certainly, if M is small compared to temperature, then this holographic DC conductivity should match the hydrodynamic prediction. So from there, what I can do is I can read out the momentum relaxation rate when n is small compared to temperature. And then I can check whether that's actually correct. In order to check that this is correct, what I do is I compute the frequency-dependent thermal conductivity, which now has this Joule-like pole. So you remember we got these expressions from hydro. I can do the exact ADS-CFT computation as well, and then match the two. And what you see is that these are the numerical results. These are the results of some numerical computation where we numerically computed the AC thermal conductivity, again, without any value of expansion or anything. And now we're checking whether it agrees with the membrane matrix or hydrodynamic prediction. So the dots are the numerical data, and the lines are basically this prediction. So you can see that as you increase M over T, so from blue to orange, then the prediction, the agreement gets worse exactly as you would expect. But at small M over T, it's pretty good. And this is, I mean, here we're starting at M over T equals 5. So that's already pretty big. So you can imagine that if I put M over T equals 0.1, then the agreement would be even better. Another thing we did is, so you extract the location of the pole from the numerics, and then you compare it to this prediction. Right, this was matching the exact holographic results to the iterative approximation from hydro. So we can check how well this approximation works. So this is again, so the dots are the numerics, and the line is this prediction. And you can see that it agrees extremely well to fairly large values of normality. So this is like 4. Below 4 is not. You cannot see any difference between the numerics and the iterative. So, as you can see, this tunnel is doing what we want.
The fact that it works above very low point is not good. Why is that the case? Is there the relevant parameter which controls, you know, the connection? It is not just M by T, but some M by T with some extra factor of 4 or 5 or something.
So what happens is that as you increase M over T, then momentum is relaxing more quickly. So these perturbative expressions that you have, they are less and less valid. So So you either need to correct them order by order, but at some point, as I will explain later on, you cross over to a completely incoherent regime where there's just no low lying code, so you should just forget about that attention. We'll get there in a few slides.
Why does it hold for like so long? Does not start emitting much of it. Is there a simple reason for
that? That I think it's just related to this particular model. Probably if you tweaked the action by including various decorations on the couplings, then you could change that value. I don't think that this is very significant. So as I said, in the previous slide, I assumed that for small m of d, the hyperdynamic formula should be applicable, and we verified numerically that we could, that this was the case. But perhaps we can do better. Perhaps we can directly compute the momentum relaxation weight in this theory and show that this is what it should be. And you remember we had this memory matrix formula right here. Yeah, let me forget about this. But at the beginning of the talk, I told you that you can use the memory matrix to get a prediction for the momentum relaxation rate. So I had an operator O that breaks translations in my holographic prime model. That's the field of psi. So in principle, I should be able to use that formula, compute the spectral weight of psi, and get a formula for gamma that does not assume any hydrodynamic regime. So that's what we're going to do now. This is the second holographic calculation that I want to show you guys. And we're going to do this, and we're going to show that this is the correct result. So if I apply to our climb model, this formula for the memory matrix rate, it collapses to this. Now there's no, so notice that I've basically gotten rid of the integral of the wave vectors, but this is because my source is linear in x. So there's no integral over momentum. If it was a more generally spatially dependent source, then I would have to keep the integral. But because I made this ansatz, which gives me homogeneous coordinate differential equations, then you can forget about the integral over wave vectors. And then what I've done is this h is now my parameter n. So as you see, the h squared becomes an m squared. And the one over chi pp that's here is just the one over st here. And now what I want to do is compute the low frequency limit of the spectral weight of the operator psi x in the translation invariant theory. This is the nice thing. Because this is a perturbative formula in small n, then at leading order, since I already have an n squared singal in front, I can just evaluate the spectral weight in the translation invariant theory. So I've reduced the problem of computing this momentum relaxation rate to just holographically compute the retarding Green's function of a scalar operator in the translation invariant background. So let's do that. So to compute this, what I need to do is solve the delta psi fluctuation equation in a translation invariant background. Essentially, so in the Schwarzschild radius background, in my case. Then, by using the standard holographic normalization formula, I know that if I expand the scalar field fluctuation towards the boundary of ADS, I get, as always, two terms. One is the source, one is the BEV. In my case, because this is a massless scalar, the source is r to the 0, and the BEV is 1 over r cubed. If I had a massive scalar, then you can modify these formulas, but in my case, this is just what they are. And then there's this general heuristic formula that you can make more precise by doing the actual holographic normalization computation, but the heuristic formula is that if you want to compute the retarding Green's function of the operator psi, then you take the ratio of the BEV divided by the source. So essentially, we're going to compute these two objects, delta psi 3 and delta psi naught, take the ratio, get the spectral weights. So for that, we use a trick. It's a very nice analytical trick. So, as always, since we have a translation invariant theory and we're interested in transport coefficients at zero wave vector, then I decompose the equation as a plane wave with just some e to the minus I omega t. frequency dependence. I plug that in the fluctuation equation from psi, and the result that I get is an equation that looks like this. It's a second order differential equation for my perturbation. There are some factors of the metric background that appear. And then there's some frequency dependence that appears at order omega squared. So this is important. It means that any frequency dependence coming from the equation of motion only appears at quadratic order in frequency. Keep that in mind, because two bullet points are after this. As I was saying before, we need to impose ingoing boundary conditions. Essentially, what that means is that this delta psi perturbation should be some constant at the horizon, times r minus rh to the minus I omega t root 4 pi t. If I had a plus, this would be outgoing boundary conditions, but since I'm on ingoing, I have a minus. And then there's some 1 plus the dots are terms that are regular as r to rh. Now, since what I'm interested in is the low frequency limit, I can just expand this boundary from these ingoing boundary conditions at small frequencies. So when I expand this factor here, what I get is a 1 minus I omega over 4 pi t log r minus rh plus higher order in frequency and r minus rh. But you see that, so what this means is that essentially, since all I care about is the omega to zero limits, and what I care about is the imaginary part of the retarded Green's function, the imaginary part of the retarded Green's function is going to be captured by this term. So I can just forget about all higher order terms in frequency. So in particular, it means that I can just solve this equation of motion as omega equals zero, because all the omega squared terms would do is give me subleading terms in frequency. Will not give me any correction. They cannot give me any corrections to these two terms. So now when I look at the omega to zero equation, so you can see that you can basically integrate it just by eye, and it has the typical structure that you expect from these kind of equations. There are two independent solutions. One is a solution that's regular at the horizon, and the other one is a solution that blows up at the horizon. And they just read like that. So I've just integrated this by that. And now what I do is I expand it close to RH. And I find that so this term does nothing, that's just a constant. But this integral I can approximate it and integrate it, and it gives me a log term. But now, from the previous arguments, it must be this expression that is this one. It just has to. This constant actually needs to be some frequency dependent number that make these two terms match, because that's all I have. I'm not allowed any, I've neglected all the rest of the frequency dependence. So actually I can just promote the full solution to this in the whole bulk. This was a solution defined in the whole bulk. I extended it close to the horizon. But then I see that at small frequencies it has to match this one, so that I can just promote this solution to the full bulk. So this is an example of a matching calculation, where I have a solution that's valid at omega equals zero, the principle, or close to the boundary, where you can neglect the effects of frequency. I have a solution that's valid close to the horizon, which is this one. But then I take a limit, which is small omega, that allows me to match these two solutions in a region where they overlap. And essentially, this is what allows me to fix this integration constant like that. This is where the UV part, and this is the IR part, and I'm matching the two in a region where the two solutions overlap. So now I can just take this solution that's valid in the whole bulk at small frequencies, and I can read off these coefficients by expanding close to the boundary and take the ratio. So I do that, then I take the ratio, compute the imaginary part of the omega, then the omega goes to zero, and what I find is a very simple answer. I just find RH squared. And then, let me remind you that this was our prediction for the momentum relaxation rate. M squared over ST times the spectral weight. So this is just RH squared. I plug it in, I remember that the entropy density is 4 pi times the area of the horizon. That's Rx squared as well. I simplify the result and I get n squared over 4 pi t, which is what I had identified previously. So here what I was trying to show you is that first we could do nice things in holography, and also I wanted to give you some typical examples of calculations that you do when you apply ADS-CFT. And also I guess I wanted to convey the message that yes, you can do complicated numerics, but you can also find tricks that allow you to do many things in a way that you go quite a long way. So that's my advice for you. Don't always jump directly into numerics. Okay, so this was all in this regime. So we were here on the left side of that picture. Do you have any questions about this, by the way? Because now I want to move to that side of the picture. Okay, so now let's see what happens when we increase momentum relaxation and essentially momentum becomes short-lived. So if momentum is short-lived, then it decouples from the low energy effective theory, from the late time effective theory. It's one of these short operators that just goes away. So if you remember, here I'm thinking about a system that's at zero density. Think back about the hydrodynamic formula that I showed you at the beginning. What did I have? I had conservation of energy, conservation of momentum, and conservation of density. But now I'm working at zero density, so conservation of density is gone. And I'm in a regime where momentum relaxes quickly, so momentum relaxation is also gone. All I'm left with is energy conservation. So it's this equation. Because I'm at zero density, this energy current is the same as the heat current. And I can use some constitutive relation to a heat current. But what am I left with? You remember these constitutive relations that I gave at the beginning, I had three kinds of terms. I had terms proportional to the velocity at zero further in derivatives. But there's no velocity anymore, there's no momentum. So that's gone. I had terms proportional to gradients of the chemical potential, but I'm at zero density, so these are also gone. So all I'm left with, really, are at any order in derivatives, derivatives of the temperature. So that's the only thing that I can write to give a positive relation to my one remaining part. So that's essentially what you do. Didn't write it. Sorry. So kappa bar just is the single remaining transport coefficients. Right here. So now you need the relation I can give to the heat current is this plus Sabine terms. But now this equation essentially just reduces to the diffusion equation because I will have dt from quantity and then I have a gradient that acts on this gradient, so it's two derivatives, and I can relate temperature to energy using static susceptibility. So that's just a diffusion equation. So what I expect is that if I compute the frequency dependent thermal conductivity, then I should get something that looks like a diffusive bulb. So this is what a diffusive bulb looks like, if you remember. And using these hydrodynamic equations, what you show is that the DC thermal conductivity should just be some heat capacity, so T dS over dt times this diffusion. So again, you can check that numerically, but you can check what happens. So what we did is compute this object, frequency dependent thermal conductivity, and look at the location of the bulb at zero wave vector. This is at zero wave vector still. So here what we're seeing is that there's this, at small m over t, there's this Joule-like bulb very close to the neural axis. Then we are increasing momentum relaxation, it's coming down, coming down, coming down, and at some point it divides with another pole that's going up from the lower half plane, and it splits into two poles that have a real part. So this is essentially this coherent-incoherent crossover. We see that at the beginning, we only have one pole that's very close to the real axis, Now this pool is coming down and getting closer to other pools that are UV pools, or pools of order temperature. And I cannot just truncate it down into that. So that's one thing that you see. Another thing that you see is you can check the dispersion relation for this pool. So you see we have I omega, so omega actually minus I dk squared. So I can extract the location of that pool, and I can compare d, which is related to the DC thermal conductivity. That's still the same holographic formula that we computed before, right? That formula did not make any assumption on the value of the primary pair. It studied both for slow and fast momentum condensation. So I know what this is, and I certainly know what this is as well. The heat capacity rate was computed from my black hole. So I can compute D. And so here what we're checking is that, again, the prediction from this version of hydrodynamics, which is just pure diffusion, agrees with the numerics. You see that it agrees extremely well. So this is at m over t equals 100, and this is as a function of k. This is the location of the pole. So this is k squared. So it's indeed a diffusive problem. So here, again, the message I'm trying to convey is that this holographic time model captures exactly the physical characteristics that we expect in these two different regimes. The coherent regime, where momentum relaxes slowly, and the incoherent regime, where all you left it with is diffusion.
I think this pole motion, I mean, when they come down, do they actually coincide and then
yes.
Is there anything significant about the coincidence point?
Quantitatively, no. Qualitatively, I think, again, this the general picture that will always be true is that you have this domain pool that collides or that becomes the same order as other human pools. Exactly what happens kind of depends on the details of the model. This picture is true for this simple model. But I could imagine, again, decorating it so that, let's say, instead of these real poles going like this, and you see that it looks a little bit like they want to go down, I could imagine tweaking the models so that they actually go up a little bit. And so that, I mean, this would be the non-universal term. What else did I want to say? Oh, one last thing I want to emphasize is that, right, so this was the general result that we got for the thermal conductivity using these holographic funnels. And essentially what we have is an expression for the thermal conductivity that's a UV observable, that's at the boundary. It's something that tells you, it's an object that tells you something about the dual filtering. But we've re-expressed it in terms of data at the horizon, so the entropy density, etc., by evaluating this function at the horizon. But now you see that you have to be careful in how you interpret this formula, because we saw that it has two very different interpretations depending on the value of m. Either you should think of this formula as s over gamma in the regime of slow momentum relaxation, or you should think of it as some ratio of the diffusivity divided by the heat capacity in the fast momentum relaxation regime where you have diffusion. But the magic of these calculations is that these objects equal the same thing, but the interpretation is very different. So that's always something to keep in mind. These horizon formula are very general. You find them for all kinds of conductivities, but depending on which regime you are, which physical regime you are, the boundary interpretation can be very different. Okay, that's all I wanted to say about this kind of calculations. So it's a good time to take questions. I can either stop here and tell you a little bit about this, but this needs maybe at least 10 minutes. Maybe we're a little pressed for time. So, whatever. I'm happy with the way. This is a good place to stop. It's also a good place to ask for a little bit.
We'll stop and then the other topic we can discuss.
Yeah. Any questions?
So this is kind of like one that people have presented for the concept. In terms of what's happening,
what do you study then? What do you study more complex models?
So you can do several things. One thing you can do is, you know, go to the slowly relaxing parametric regime and start computing corrections, subgradient corrections. You can turn on non-zero density, compute the electrical conductivity, and then you would find that it splits into two pieces at the horizon. But you would find that these two pieces are not the natural decomposition compared to the boundary of the nodes. So if I be a little bit more precise. So you would find that the DC conductivity is in this model. If I take the same model, just turn on some Maxwell fields on it, now you would find that this is what the DC conductivity looks like. It's 1 plus the ratio of chemical potential squared divided by parameter m squared. And again, this is given by a horizon formula, etc. So this second rewrites. Like this is, so mu is manifestly UV because we read it off from the asymptotic value of the gauge weight. But in this particular solution, I can rewrite this as like rho squared over s or something. So I can manifestly rewrite this as horizon beta. And now you might say, all right, the way I should interpret this formula is in the following way. This is the piece that comes from horizon relaxation because it goes like 1 over m squared. And from here, I can extract the momentum perturbative expression for the momentum relaxation rate that is exactly similar to what we just did and would agree with the naive Wendler matrix expectation. And this is like some quantum critical contribution. Like, you know, in the CFT when you have polyhedral pair creation, except that right now we have non-zero density. This turns out to be completely wrong at order m to the 0. That is certainly, if I look at the leading order for small m, so 1 over m squared, then I should just neglect this term. And from there, I can do the exact matching to, say, memory matrix of hydro that we did in the thermal conductivity case. And things would work very well at order 1 over m squared, so leading order. But now we're asking, what about this piece? This is subleading, this is the next order. And we want to be able to say something about this. Except that now you can see that what you should expect, so here we're trying to match this to, say, sigma naught plus chi jp squared over chi pp 1 over gamma, which is what hydro memory matrix would tell us. And at leading order, we found that gamma goes like n squared. This is what we did. But now you can very well see that, so this is order 1 in gamma in m squared, this is 1 over m squared. But you should really expect that all of these guys are going to get order m squared corrections. So if you expand out of this term, you will find that this order m squared correction here are cancelled out by 1 over m squared there and back up from this one. So this is one example of what I was trying to emphasize. Here there's this very simple decomposition in terms of horizon observables. But actually, if you want to interpret this from the boundary point of view, in terms of a contribution coming from momentum relaxation and a contribution coming from this quantum critical sector, then this is not the right decomposition. You have to work a little bit harder. What I'll talk about at the workshop is how you can use these kind of models to do not explicit symmetry breaking, but spontaneous symmetry breaking. What do I need to do to modify these types of models in order not to have explicit but spontaneous symmetry breaking? So then I can talk about crystals and charge density waves and stuff like that. This is just metals.
It's my place.
There was the last question.
Oh. You
Could you state the whole thing? just can you put up some model which shows the vibration of the field law and
so
the time for piece of energy?
So what you can typically do is you can use these models and evaluate the ratio of thermal over electric conductivity. There's nothing that prevents you from doing that. And then you would find that it might go to a constant. It could happen. In the regime of large NVT, for instance. But this constant, I mean, there's nothing fundamental about it because this is completely dependent on the details of the holographic model. So in particular, if you study grouping header with corrections and changes, etc.
Generally, if you compute in any other model, you see that it's not a constant and maybe it depends on some.
So it would not generally, it would generally be some function of T and M and U, temperature, the translation symmetry, gradient parameter, and the chemical potential. And maybe by taking certain units, you could see some saturation somewhere, etc. But this is not going to be fundamental. The more fundamental part would be what I'd like to discuss, the possibility that there are some fundamental bounds on certain transport coefficients. Because then this is telling you that, say, the electrical conductivity can be smaller than a certain value, and this would then affect this Biedermann Franz ratio. But this is a slightly different take than what we were discussing. Because here, the weakly coupled case, the fact that the Biedermann Franz ratio is universal is really because these two quantities in the numerator and denominator are controlled by the same time scale, and this drops out. Whereas here, what I'm saying is that maybe separately each of these transport coefficients might obey some bounds, and so the ratio would also be bounded. But what will be fundamental is not the ratio, it will be the transport coefficient itself.
Okay, guys, let's go into the for lunch.